just immigrated Chinese mom who teaches her kids there's no God because that's all she's ever known. Where the world sees a crowd, we see a person close up. We're the ones who speak hope to them. We're the missionaries you send when you give to the Annie Armstrong Easter offering. We see what hope can do, and we can't sit still. Because this hope is the hope of the gospel. It's a powerful thing. It pushes us to leave whatever is comfortable. It shows the lost someone is looking for them. And it gives you and us a mission to complete together. In Puerto Rico and Portland and Montreal and Miami, in college towns and small towns and big cities, in every language, in every North American life, Jesus saves. We've seen it. And all he asks is that we, missionaries, churches, everyday believers, share what we have. Give to the Annie Armstrong Easter offering. And this is what happens. New churches start. Those who are far off are brought near. And together, we send hope.
December, we have the Lottie Moon Christmas offering, which is for international missions. Similar to that, in the month of March, we have the Annie Armstrong offering, which hopefully is everybody's okay back there. And we have the Annie Armstrong offering, which is for North American missions. And so, as you prayerfully consider how God would have you participate in that, we set a goal for $1,000 for our Annie Armstrong Easter offering, so you pray about that. I want to remind you, as we already tweeted, we're right in the middle of sign up for the women's retreat coming up in April, a year before we know it, so we encourage you to sign up for that. This coming Wednesday, what happens at 11:30? Senior lunch. See, I got it. It's 11:30, not 12, at all the board of this Wednesday in Mansfield. And one last thing, there's a sign up over here. I'm going to be starting a men's group where we're going to be going through the book. We're going to go through the book, Gene Getz's book, The Measure of a Man. It's the 20. We'll be looking at unpacking the 20 characteristics of a godly man according to the scriptures. And so if you're interested in that, there's two options. There's a 7 a.m. option, and there's a 7 p.m. option. So if one of those times works for you, and you'd like to be in that group, you can sign up over on the table over here, okay? So we like to give the opportunity this week. By the way, if you're a guest today, if you've never filled out one of those Connect cards in the pocket, we encourage you to do that. That way we can
Aren't you glad you live in a country that you can come and do this without being hauled to jail? I think we should take every opportunity to worship our Father that we can before that privilege is taken away.
Thank you. Right. Father, thank you that victory is not in our efforts, it's not in our resolve to be good or do good, but our victory is in you. Our victory was accomplished for us on the cross as your Son shed his blood for us to deal with the sin that we could never deal with on our own. Father, thank you for forgiveness. Father, thank you for forgiveness of even the greatest things, those things that we think we could never get past or we could never be forgiven of or will cripple us. Father, thank you for the depth of your forgiveness. Father, thank you as we begin to look at this week, to look at the cross and to see what you accomplished for us on the cross. Father, help us to just be able to bask in that forgiveness and really grasp and understand what that means. So, Father, as we continue to worship you, we just make ourselves available to you in this time as we get into your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I got to remember how to push this button. There we go. All right. Should have did this before I got up here. So, this morning, we begin a new series. If you'll turn with me to Luke chapter 23, beginning in verse 30, we're going to look at 32 through 34 in Luke chapter 23. We're going to begin a new series, Seven Words from the Cross. There are seven words, or you would, seven sayings, seven things that Jesus said from the cross. And each week we're going to unpack those, and today we look at the first of those. And let me just read it, and then we'll dive in. We're Luke chapter 23, verse 32 through 34. Two others also who were criminals were being led away to be put to death with him. When they came to the place called the Skull, there they crucified him and the criminals, one on the right and the other on the left. But Jesus was saying, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing." And they cast lots, dividing up his garments among themselves. These words were actually prophesied by Isaiah in Isaiah 53:12. Therefore, I will allot him a portion with the great, and he will divide the booty with the strong. Because he poured out himself to death, he was numbered with the transgressors, yet he himself bore the sin of many, and there it is, interceded for the transgressors. Of the four gospel writers, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Luke is the only one who records this first of seven words or sayings of Jesus on the cross. And I want us to go back, and I want us to, as we dive into this, I'm going to read our passage again, but I want to zoom in on something to make sure that you didn't miss it when we read it again. Two others also who were criminals were being led away to be put to death with him. When they came to the place called the Skull, they were crucified. There they crucified him and the criminals, one on the right side and the other on the left. And it's highlighted in yellow on the screen. But Jesus was saying, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing." But Jesus was saying. Second aorist active imperative. Jesus didn't just make the statement. He continued to repeat the statement. Most commentators believe that this statement was made. Most believe that it was made, and I happen to believe that this statement, Jesus made this statement, repeated this statement, as the cross was laid down, and as they were driving the spikes into his hands, this Jesus repeats this statement. Either as the soldiers are driving the spikes in his hand, or at least as soon as the cross was raised up in place. And he's repeating this prayer. We're going to see a broader application, but he's praying this prayer for the soldiers who are standing there with holding the hammers in their blood-splattered hands. He's praying for their... He's coming to the Lord and asking the Lord to forgive them. At the time of Jesus' most intense physical and emotional pain, Jesus is not thinking about, he's not mindful of his own innocence. He's mindful of what? He's mindful of his executioners. And Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing. As we, you're going to say, Pastor, you've only got 2 points for the sermon? Yeah, 2 points today. 2 points. The first, understanding these words ought to move us. When we hear these words, the first words that Jesus spoke from the cross, they ought to move us. First of all, these words ought to move us to grasp the gravity of our sin. We've been singing about this, but think about it. These words, in the context in which they were spoken, when Jesus said, "They do not know what they're doing," certainly he wasn't saying, "Father, forgive them because they don't realize they're crucifying me." Of course they realized they were crucifying him. This is what they professionally did. They were crucifying him, but he was saying rather, they're not grasping the gravity of what they were doing. They're crucifying the one who came to die for their sins that were keeping them from God. They did not realize that they were executing the sinless Son of God. But we got to be clear about something. They were not taking his life. You understand that, right? They were not taking his life. There's a lot of things we could go to look to see that they weren't taking his life. He was laying down his life. Let me go to my favorite place. This is John chapter 18, first eight verses. John chapter 18. This takes us back to the garden, okay? After saying these things, Jesus crossed the Kidron Valley with his disciples and entered a grove of olive trees. Judas, the betrayer, knew this place because Jesus had often gone there with his disciples. Freeze. How did Judas know when he betrayed Jesus? How did he know where to find Jesus? Because Judas had probably been with him many times in this very spot, so he knew where to go. The leading priests and Pharisees had given Judas a contingent of Roman soldiers and temple guards to accompany him. Now, with blazing torches, lanterns, and weapons, they arrive at the olive grove. Verse 4. Jesus fully realized all that was going to happen to him, so he stepped forward to meet them. "Who are you looking for?" he asked. "Jesus the Nazarene," they replied. "I am he," Jesus said. Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. Verse 6. As Jesus said, "I am he," they all drew back and fell to the ground. Did you catch what happened? Once more he asked them, "Who are you looking for?" And they replied, once again they replied, "Jesus the Nazarene." "I told you that I am he," Jesus said, "and since I'm the one you want, let these others go." Powerful scene. They come to arrest Jesus. Jesus said, "Who are you looking for?" "Jesus the Nazarene." When he said, "I am he," by the way, the same thing. Remember when Moses was at the burning bush and God said what his name was? He said, "I am." Jesus uses this to say, he says, "I am." As soon as he said that, what happened? They fell to the ground in the presence of the power of God the Son on the earth. Jesus said, "Now who is it you're asking for? Who is it you came for?" And he goes, he's giving his life. He's laying down his life. Now back to the cross. Only one of the 12 disciples that followed Jesus during the three years of his earthly ministry, only one of the disciples was there to hear the words that we're going to be talking about, and it was here to hear this. Remember who that was? The one disciple that was actually there at the cross? John. John was the one. Fast forward the tape. He's an old man now. He'd written three letters. And in this first letter, chapter 2, verse 2, he says this. He, referring to Jesus, is the atoning sacrifice of our sins. And not only for ours, but also the sins of the whole world. What did John understand that we need to understand? John understood that our sin was so great and the penalty for it so massive. The only payment that could be made to deal with our sin is for the sinless Son of God to give his life. We could never make up for the sin that we could never pay the penalty for the sin, our sin that separates us from God. The only payment that could be made was that Christ would die on the cross for us. And make no mistake, everybody in the world has this need. And as I was reflecting this week, I get teased for saying this, but crock-potting this, just letting it simmer, letting it soak in my brain and in my heart. And as I was reflecting on these words, when Jesus said, "They do not know what they're doing," and picturing the flippant actions of these soldiers, they're just crucifying three guys. It's all in a day's work. If you notice in the passage, and this is kind of a setup for next week's message, but twice Luke brings up the criminals. There were two criminals and Jesus that were led to the place called the skull, and Jesus is hung between the two criminals. What's the point? Jesus is just considered yet another criminal. The soldiers are gambling, the last verse we looked at, the soldiers are gambling for his garments at the foot of the cross. This wasn't like, oh, the highest bidder gets Michael Jackson's glove. It wasn't something like that. This was a normal thing that they would do. And in a massive show of disrespect for a dying person, they're gambling for his clothes at the foot of the cross. And as I was thinking about this, how flippant the soldiers were in this action and not understanding the gravity of what they were doing, it reminded me of how easy it is to get casual about our own salvation and how the gravity of our sin gets lost in the shuffle. And the further that we get from that time when the light came on and it dawned on us how our sin separates us from God and how desperately in need of a Savior we were. And that time when we said, God, I turn from my sin and I put my life in your hand. Do you remember when that happened to you? Somebody tell me when that happened for you. When was that? When did it happen for you? 11 years old. 12 years old. 27. 5? 5 over here, one of the kids. 16. I was a sophomore in high school. But it struck me, the further we get away from that time, maybe the easier it is for us to get lax and forget about the freedom that we need to continue to walk in. The magnitude of our sin. We tend to take what Jesus did for granted, and if you would, we don't even know we're doing it. Why is it so imperative that we grasp the gravity of our sin? When we grasp the gravity of our sin, we stay connected to the reality that we desperately need God every day. Every day. It's so easy for us to just kind of rock along, to get a verse here and there, and oh, here's a great devotional thought that we get off of a podcast, and hey, that helps get me through the day. And then day after day, and week after week, and maybe month after month, we wake up one day and we realize, well, you know what? I've been living in my own power with a few scriptures sprinkled in just for good measure, just kind of keep me going. And we miss out on how desperate we are, and maybe we, over time, we fall into bondage and we find ourselves so desperate that we just collapse into his arms and say, Father, without even realizing it, I've slipped into this bondage. And we come back and realize our desperation for him. Every day, John 15:5, Jesus said, I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who remain in me and I in them will produce much fruit. For apart from me, you can do what? Nothing. Nothing. As soon as we feel like, I got this, guess what? We don't got this. When we grasp the gravity of our sin, we regularly confess our sin so that we can continue to walk in freedom of God's forgiveness. It's easy for us to get so caught up in being confident in the good life that we're living for God that we maybe neglect or we overlook sin that creeps in and binds us. It's kind of like the college that finally got a football team, and they said, well, we got a football team, so we need to get a mascot. So they decided they were going to get a goat for a mascot. Then they thought, we got a goat for a mascot. What are we going to do with the goat? A couple of the college students said, I know, we can keep the goat in our dorm room. Well, the athletic director said, well, that's a great idea, but what are you going to do about the smell? And the guy said, well, the goats will get used to it. And sometimes that's the way it is with sin in our life. We get used to it. But you know what? God doesn't. And it's a block. It's a block. And we ought to be praying daily, as like David prayed in Psalm 138:23-24. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. And point out anything in me that offends you and lead me along the paths of everlasting life. When we grasp the gravity of our sin, guess how we live? We live in humility. We become more humble. Why? Because we understand it's not us that did this. It's only God in us. When we grasp the gravity of our sin and we live with that daily realization that any goodness we have, it's all of Him and none of us, guess what? People don't just see us. They see Christ in us. And that is attractive. You see, we work so hard at making ourselves look good so that, and the thought is, if I look so good, if I get to be such a good looking person, then others will look at me and say, wow, I want to be a Christian. He's a great person. I ought to be a Christian like that. And guess what? We don't even realize what we're doing. First of all, it's exhausting trying to keep ourselves looking good, right? And then we realize it comes across as pride. And then we realize that people around us smell plastic a mile away. Don't you want people to see Christ in you? Every day, on a daily basis, we ought to be going before the Lord and saying, God, thank you for saving me. I grasp the gravity of my sin. I know what sin does in my life. And Lord, if there's anything that's slipped in, known or unknown, Father, help me to deal with that. Because I don't want anything to keep you from shining through me. Oh, we've got to grasp the gravity of our sin. We've got to know what we're doing. That takes us right to point number two. Because when we grasp the gravity of our sin, guess what we do? We start treating other people like Jesus did. So when we understand these words, when we grasp the understanding of Jesus saying, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. We emulate the example of our Savior. In these words, there's a lot of practical, powerful examples of how we ought to live our life. Let's just get in and see what some of those are. One is the prominence and the power of prayer in our lives. Jesus, you know, Jesus died when he was 33 years old. The last 3 years was his public ministry. You know, his public ministry was inaugurated in prayer. Do you remember when it was? It was when he was baptized. His public ministry was, the inauguration was his baptism. In Luke 3:21, now when all the people were baptized, Jesus was also baptized, and while he was praying, the heavens opened up. Jesus began his ministry in prayer, and now we see him on the cross. He's ending his ministry in prayer. A couple of side notes. Something that maybe that's so profound and so that we might miss is this, and it struck me this week. Jesus, he was no longer able at this point to reach out and touch and heal a blind person. A person of the, he wasn't able to minister by touching them, because his hands were nailed to a cross. He wasn't able to physically walk over and minister to someone because his feet are now nailed to a cross. If you would, Jesus, in this 6 hours, the Friday of the last week of his life, in those 6 hours, if you would, Jesus was disabled. There may be some that are listening to this message via speaker, listening to this online. Watch this. Huge application. Don't miss it. You might find yourself in a place where you think, Lord, why? Why am I confined to this bed? Why can I not get out of this wheelchair? Why can I not leave my home? I'm I'm bound. Oh, don't forget, Jesus was bound. And the most powerful ministry he did was prayer. Never underestimate the power of prayer. Oh, the power. We say, oh, well, we got to do all. Well, all we can do now is pray. No, the greatest thing we can do is pray. And that's the powerful. We went to the, Albert Lilly and I got to attend the evangelism conference Monday and Tuesday of this week. And we were reminded that if there's someone that you want to see come know the Lord, you know what you do first? Yeah, we ought to be building the relationship and, you know, nailing planks in the bridge into their life and spending time with them, doing all those things. But you know what the very first thing we need to be doing is? We need to be praying for them. Praying for them. And it might be that that person that you think, you know what? Yeah, well, I know there's a lot of people that could and will get saved, but that person, what we're hearing in this on the cross, you know what we're hearing? We're hearing and we're seeing no one. I mean, these are the guys that were nailing these are the guys that were crucifying, executing the sinless Son of God. How much greater could your sin get, right? But they weren't out of the reach of God. And Jesus lifts them up in prayer. He listened to the Father. Is there anybody that you feel like is out of the reach of God's grace? Uh-uh, not there. It might be that something in your life, you think, you know what? God can't forgive me for that. Guess again. God can forgive you if you submit it to Him. Just give it to Him. Jesus taught us pray for your enemies. And here He does it, Matthew 5:44. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. This is what He's doing on the cross. He's praying for those who are executing Him. Okay, very, very practical. Let's talk about something that's extremely practical that we see in this prayer that Jesus is doing that we need to do in our relationships with each other, okay? You've heard me say this, and you've heard me say this over and over and over. You ever have a question, how should I act in my relationship with anybody, whether it's your spouse or your kids or your neighbor or your work associate, you know, fellow person in the church? How did God treat us? And here's a really good example. These that are doing Christ wrong, if you would, they're persecuting, they're nailing Him to the cross. What does He do? Father, forgive them. What's He doing? He's releasing them to the Father. When does a person experience forgiveness? A person experiences forgiveness when they do what? When they confess. Remember 1 John 1:9? If we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins, cleanse us from all righteousness. Christ on the cross is providing forgiveness as they are, as they're doing Him wrong, as they're executing Him, He's releasing them to the Father. What is our natural tendency? Retaliation, revenge. We jokingly say, I don't get mad, I don't get even, I get ahead. And revenge, payback, hold a grudge, hang on to it until the bitterness sets in so much that it eats us alive. That's a tendency, right? What does love do? A little some excerpt from 1 Corinthians 13. Love is kind. Love does not seek its own. Love does not take into account a wrong suffered. Love bears all things. Love endures all things. And then Paul gives us some practical advice in Ephesians 4:31-32. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, harsh words, and slander, as well as all types of behavior. And if we stop there, we say, okay, but get rid of that because I know it's going to clean my clock, but what do we do? He goes on, verse 32. Instead, be kind to each other, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, just as Christ has forgiven you. Did you catch what he's saying? He's saying our point. Emulate the example of our Savior. So the way to get rid of those things that settle in when someone does us wrong and the roots of bitterness and rage and all that sets in is to be kind-hearted, tender, forgive them, just as Christ has forgiven you. The example that Christ gives us on the cross, release them to the Father. Turn them over to the Father, let it go, and turn them over to the Father. And this is going to be a lot easier for me to say, and for you to nod your head and say amen, than it actually is to do it. Because why? Because the flesh is crying out against this. The flesh cries out for us to do something. Don't miss the power of that last phrase, just as God through Christ has forgiven you. You remember our first point? Grasp the gravity of our sin. When we grasp the gravity of our sin, guess what? It puts us in a position of being a whole lot easier to release others because of their sin, right? There's more. Here's another of Jesus' teaching that he modeled on the cross, and we find it in Luke 6, 27 and 28. But to you who are willing to listen, I say, by the way, he says, but to you who are willing to listen, implying there's some that aren't willing to listen to this, okay? He said, but for you two who are willing to listen, I say, love your enemies. Here it is. Hard part. Everybody ready? Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who hurt you. Very, very practically, very practical word. Jesus didn't just stop at saying, pray for your enemies. What did he do? He had to go on and say, do something good for those who do wrong to you. Bless them. Jesus is dying on the cross for the forgiveness of those who are nailing him to the cross. He's doing the ultimate of good deeds. Someone's done you wrong. Someone slapped you emotionally or did you wrong financially or however way. What do? You pray for them. You release them to God. They experience forgiveness when they own up to what they've done. But what we've got to have to do is we've got to turn them over to the Lord. If we hang on to it, it eats our lunch. It cleans our clock and starts manifesting all kind of weird ways in our life. We release them to the Lord, and then we take that next step, and this is hard, and I've done this recently, and I can vouch that this is powerful. Do something to bless that person. Do something. And what does that do? There's a couple of things that does. One, it diffuses the bitterness and the rage and the anger that will destroy us if we don't. And the other thing it does is it allows Christ's unconditional love to shine through us in a way that God can use us to draw them to himself. That's what's happening on the cross. Jesus is laying down his life and he's letting his executioners go. And we're going to stay tuned because next week, this statement that Jesus makes here, it's going to come into play in the words that we're going to look at that Christ said next week. Romans 2:4, I love this. Or do you think lightly of the riches of his kindness and tolerance and patience, not knowing that the kindness of God leads you to repentance? When we bless those who do wrong to us, guess what? That kindness can lead them to repentance. John, remember the only disciple is at the cross? Another thing that he said in that first of three letters that he wrote was this. John 4:19 simply said this. We love because God loved us first. How do you display this kind of love? How do you display love that lets a person go that did you wrong? How do you display love that does something good or blesses someone who's done you wrong? How do you do that? Only in Christ can you do that. And if you're sitting there thinking, I could never do that. Yes, you can. In Christ. Want an example? Got a great one for you in Acts chapter 7. A powerful example of following Jesus' example was Stephen. Remember this guy? Stephen? In Acts chapter 7, they went on stoning Stephen as he called on the Lord and said, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And then in verse 60, then falling on his knees, he cried out with a loud voice, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. Having said this, he fell asleep. There's another powerful part of the story. Back up a verse. When they had driven Stephen, him, out of the city, they began stoning him, and the witnesses laid aside their robes at the feet of a young man named Saul. You know who Saul was? Paul, who wrote from the verses that we just finished reading. Don't miss the power of releasing your enemies who are out to destroy you to the Lord, because it makes a difference. Saul was standing there. If we go forward to Acts 8:1, it says that Saul was standing there giving hearty agreement to Stephen's execution. And I can't help but believe that this was one of the things that God used to prepare Saul for that day when he was on the road to have some more Christians executed, when he met the risen Lord and he fell on his knees, and it was an instantaneous salvation. We're going to talk about instantaneous salvation next week, but here it is, an example of Saul on the road to Damascus. Something happens in us and in those that we connect with when we demonstrate the love of Christ that was displayed on the cross in these words. It starts when we grasp the gravity of our sin and we embrace our desperation for God. This morning, as we have a time of reflection, just some questions. Have you had that time in your life when the gravity of your sin, you grasped it in such a way that you understood, if something's not done to deal with that, I'm going to spend a Christless eternity away from God in a place called hell? You ever come to that point where you realize that, wow, my sin is so deep and so entrenched and it's so offensive to Holy God that there's no way I can clean this up? And then you come to realize that God dealt with that. He made provision for it. He sent Jesus to die on the cross. And then you realize, that's my home. And you turn from sin. By the way, confession and faith, two sides of the same coin. When we turn from our sin and we put our faith in Christ, it's an act. You put your faith in Him. You turn from sin, put your faith in Him, say, Lord, like John 1:12 says, I receive you and I want to become your child. I want to just be one of your creations. I want to be one of your children. You've never had that time when you received Christ as your Savior. I pray that today would be that day. I'm going to be here and I would love for you to just come and I could help you with a simple prayer that when you could just give your life to Christ. Do that right here, right now today. It might be that you've had that time, you've taken that step, and you put your trust in Him, but as time's gone, can't relax. Maybe in this moment, the Holy Spirit, maybe there's something to deal with you. Something that you just kind of let slide, and whether it's there's sins of omission and commission, maybe there's something you've done, something you haven't done, and God's going to press on you. You know what? We are walking full fellowship and freedom again. You need to clean that up. Maybe in this time of reflection, it would be something like that. You just go before God and say, God, I'm going to make this right. You can pray right where you are. You can come to the altar and pray. However God does this. And finally, in this time of reflection, it might be that as we talk about it, if you think about these words, Jesus prayed, Father, forgive them. They don't realize what they're doing. Maybe there's someone in your life that's done you wrong. It might even be they don't even realize they've done you wrong. They don't realize the gravity of what they've done. Whether they do or don't, guess what you need to do? You need to release it to the Lord. Because if you don't, it will clean your emotional clock, trust me. And it might be in this moment that what you do is say, Lord, yeah, I've been holding this, and it's like a cancer. It's taking me down. I need to trust you with this. And you trust it to the Lord. Whether
they ever confess it and make it right, that's between them and the Lord. But you let it go. And then, Lord, that next step, that really tough step, Lord, what is it that you have me to do? Bless that person. And so, Father, thank you for these powerful words that. Father, thank you for these powerful words that you spoke on the cross. And the difference that these words can make when we let them settle in and invade our hearts, penetrate our minds. Lord, help us to, in this moment, or if there's anyone here that's never begin that glorious and free walk with you, today be the day that just turn life over. Put your trust in them. Father, if there's anyone here today that maybe has something that they, an offense or something that someone's done wrong, and maybe they just want you to let it go. Father, give them the courage, give them the understanding to be able to just trust that person to you. Oh, Father, thank you for how practical your word is. Thank you for showing us how to live so we can live. We can live free. We can live empowered. While we make ourselves available for whatever you want to do in our hearts and minds in this time, in Jesus' name. It's all so good.
Forgive.
giving of our tithes and offerings. So far, let's just come forward. Father, thank you for your provision for us. We're talking in this series about how you've provided for us forgiveness on the cross, salvation on the cross. All that we need for living, you've provided on the cross. Father, thank you for the reminder at this time that even what we have materially, you've provided for us. So, Father, thank you for the opportunity through this very practical time of worship to give you back a portion of it as an expression of our understanding. It all came from you. Father, we celebrate your blessing upon us, and we anticipate your continued work through us. So, Father, this morning we give you joy in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Sleeves, the angels putting on a rip.
Our God is an awesome God.
There is thunder in his footsteps and lightning in his fists.
Our God is an awesome God.
And the Lord was a joking when he kicked him out of Eden. It wasn't for the reason that he shed his blood. His return is very soon, so you better be believing
that our God is an awesome God. Our God.
Darkness and created the light.
Our God is an awesome God.
Judgment and wrath he poured out on Sodom. Mercy and grace he gave us at the cross. I hope that we have not too quickly forgotten
that our God is an awesome God. Our God.
So glad that you're here. Hope you have a wonderful week. Paul Dannenberg, our associate pastor.
Father,
God,
we thank you so much for the opportunity we have to serve you. Help us, Lord, as we meet here today to remember that Bishop Field is just as we walk and help these rules. Father, that as we are out there, help us remember the words that Christ said upon the cross. Forgive them, Lord. Help us to have that on our hearts. Guide us.